Creating abstract shapes like these can seem like a daunting task for beginners and early intermediates, but Blender has some hidden features which allow you to create shapes like these easily. These features I'm talking about is actually a built-in Blender add-on called Tissue. I call it built-in since I don't have to download anything from the internet, as it's already inside Blender, which is really handy. Let's start off by enabling this add-on. I'll first go to Edit, and then I'll left-click Preferences. Once you're in Preferences, you can left-click Add-ons, left-click the search bar, and just search for Tissue. Then you can left-click the box here to enable it. And finally, you can left-click these three bars, left-click Save Preferences, and you can close this window. Now we have our add-on enabled, you can find it here on our side panel. If you can't see the side panel, you can just press N to open or close it. We're not going to use it just now though, because we're going to go ahead and create our base shape. To do that, I'm going to add a shape called a torus, which looks a bit like a bagel or a donut. You can press Shift A, and then under Mesh, you can left click Torus. If I zoom in here, you can see we have this ring shape. I'm just going to leave everything as it is, and I'm going to press Tab to go into Edit Mode. Edit Mode allows us to change the geometry of our object. You can see I can left click individual faces to select them and press G to move them. You can also move the individual points by pressing 1 on the keyboard to select vertices, 2 on the keyboard to select edges, and 3 on the keyboard to select faces. You can also rotate these faces by pressing R, make them bigger or smaller by pressing S for scale, and if you want to come out of edit mode, you just press Tab. You can think of Tab as a way to toggle between object and edit mode, which you can also change up here. Now I want to make my torus a bit thicker, so I'm going to press A, which will allow us to select all. I like to think of this as A for all. Then you can press Alt and then S, and this will, rather than scale it, it will increase the radius. And now we've got a thicker shape. Now we're going to create something called a component. This is a term used for tissue, and our torus will act as our base. So you can think of a component as something we'll place on the base. This will make more sense once we put everything together. So I'll press Shift A, and then under Mesh, I'm going to left click Plane. Then I'll press G and Y to pull this out. I'm then going to come down to my modifier properties, which is this blue spanner icon. I'll then press Add Modifier, and I'm going to choose Subdivision Surface. You can see it's turned our square into a more rounded shape. I'll increase my levels viewport here, which will make our component we're making more smooth. In order to make our corners more hard, we can left click this advanced button, and where it says boundary smooth, we can change it from all to keep corners. Then I'm going to press Tab to go into edit mode for this, and you can see we've only got one face here. I'm going to press 2 to go into edge select mode, and this allows us to select individual edges. I'll then press Control R, which will allow us to add a loop cut. A loop cut is just a loop that goes around the object. Once I left click, you can see I can move it around, but I'm going to right click to keep it in the middle. The way I remember this hotkey is you can think of it as Control and then R for rope. So you're controlling a rope around the object or adding a loop. Now I want to create 3 more loops here, so I could either press Control R and then add another 2 loops this way, or alternatively I could left click this edge here and press Control B to create 2 more edges like this. You can then scroll your mouse wheel up in order to add an extra loop, or you can left click when you're satisfied and open this menu in the bottom left hand corner here to make some adjustments. For example, you can change your segments here to 2, and now you can see we have 3 edges. I also changed my width to 0.5, so everything is perfectly in the center. Now I'm going to left click my edge here, and we can hold down Shift left click to select multiple things. This works in object mode as well. I'll then press G and Z and pull this up, and you can see we've got a nice smooth pattern here. The reason this is smooth is because of the subdivision surface modifier we added. If I was to disable this by pressing this monitor button, which disables the modifier in the viewport is this workspace here. You can now see we have a very rigid object, like how it's seen in edit. I'll put it back on for now. I'm sidetracking here, but another thing to know about modifiers, which some beginners may value in knowing, is you can actually apply them to turn them into actual geometry. Notice how right now our geometry looks like this, and now if I left click this and press apply, and then go back in, you can see that it's actually become physical geometry. I'll press Ctrl Z to undo that, because sometimes it's not desirable to apply modifiers in case you want to make further adjustments later. You can also right click it and press Shade Smooth in order to create a smooth appearance. Now, I want to take my component here and place it all over my torus, but I'm wanting to do it in this diagonal pattern, and you can see that we've just got straight up and down squares. And because Tissue will add this component on each square, it won't be diagonal. So there's two solutions to this. One is to make a diagonal component, or you can make the torus itself diagonal. Since it's easier to make the torus diagonal, I'm going to do that. So first, I'll left click the torus, making sure I'm in object mode. Then, where the blue spanner or wrench is, I'm going to left click add modifier, and I can just left click the search bar and search for decimate. I'll then left click to add the modifier. I'm going to change it from collapse to unsubdivide and change the iterations to 1. And straight away, you can see that we now have diamond shapes for each of our squares. These squares in 3D are called quads. If you see a triangle face in 3D, you would actually call these tries, and if you have a face with more than 5 edges, you would call that an n-gon. If I press Tab to go into edit mode, you can see we have our original geometry still. So in this case, I'm actually going to apply the modifier. So I'll come to my decimate modifier, left-click this button, and press apply. Now, we're going to try and add this component to our torus. So I'm going to left-click the component, and then shift-left-click the base, which is our torus. It's important you do this in the right order, so make sure to select the component first. If you're unsure if you select it in the right order, remember, the thing you select last will be highlighted yellow, and anything you selected before will be orange. If I now left-click the tissue here in the side menu, remember, you can press N to open it. I can then press Tessellate. I'll leave all these settings as is, and just press OK. And now you can see, it's placed our component all over our torus. You can see things look a little jagged, so I'll press right-click and choose Shade Smooth. But you'll notice how we don't have these orientated in the right way. You'll also notice that if I left-click this and press G, it's actually created a brand new torus for us. So what I'll do is I'll press G and Y to move this along. G for grab, and then Y to move it along this green line, which is actually the Y axis, as shown here. The first way I can fix this orientation is to do it manually. So I could left click my torus and press Tab. Then what I could do, I could go into face select mode by pressing 3 on the keyboard, left click one of the faces, and if I press right, for example, you can see the face on the tessellated one has now rotated. Flip will rotate it 180 degrees, so you'll notice no significant change for our case. Left will move it 90 degrees in the other direction. Thankfully, while this method works well, it's very time consuming, so there's an easy way to go about fixing this. If you remember when we pressed the tessellate button, a bunch of options came up, and we can actually edit these options by left-clicking our tessellation here, and then left-clicking our green triangle here. This is called the Object Data Properties menu. We can come down to where it says Tissue Tessellate, and here we've got all of our settings. First, we have our Fill Mode, and we're only going to talk about two of them today. Quad will place the component on each face. The reason it's called Quad is because it works best with quads. And if you remember, a quad is a face with four edges, or four vertices, whereas a face or a polygon with three edges would be a tri, or a face with five or more edges or vertices would be called an n-gon. So quad just means this would work best with quad squares. And it will also place the component on each one of these squares. We'll talk about patch a little bit later, but it's essentially something that allows you to place a component on a face before considering the quads that a subdivision surface will add, meaning we can retain the smoothness, but we can still keep the same amount of quads. This will make more sense when we show it later. Another common setting we use is merge. If I leave this off and press Tab to go into edit mode, and I press L to select one of these linked faces and move them, you can see this comes separated. Whereas if I was to enable merge, and then press Tab again, and then press L, you can see all these are now connected. And if I was to move a face near the point where they were separated before, you can see it's now all connected. Since these aren't all correctly orientated, it's not going to be able to merge everything properly. Another few settings to keep in mind are these thickness settings. If I change the scale here, we can increase the intensity of the component on the tessellation. I'll press Ctrl Z to undo this. Finally, under rotation, there are a few options, and here where it says default, we're going to be changing this to active UV later to get the automatic orientation we want, but for now, I'm just going to leave it on default. This shift value is also very handy when you're using the UV. With that explained, let's go on to making a UV. I'll left click my base here, since we're going to need to edit it. I'll press Tab to go into edit mode, and I'm also going to want to bring out a second workspace called the UV editor, just so I can better explain how this works. To do this, I'll come up to the top left hand corner until a cross shape appears, and then I'll left click and drag to pull this out. You can see this pulls out a second 3D viewport. I can then change from 3D viewport here to UV editor, and this will allow us to edit our UV and view it. Right now, if I press A to select everything, this is our default torus UV, which as you can see, is quite messy. A UV is typically something important for texturing. It can also be used with the tissue add-on to orient things properly, as seen under the tissue tessellate rotation settings from before. We want to create some strips with our UV in order to tell Blender to orient everything in straight lines, which will create that rotation we're looking for. To do this, I'm going to want to select a bunch of edges going in the same direction. I'll press 2 to go into edge select mode in edit mode, and press alt left click, which will allow us to select a loop. Then I can press shift alt left click to select a second loop, and I'm just going to keep doing this until I've selected all the loops I need. Once you have selected all your loops with shift alt left click, it should look something like this. And now we just need to mark these as seams in order to unwrap it. Seams are like cuts, and UV unwrapping is like cutting your 3D object to turn it into a 2D form. So I'll now right click and then choose mark seam. Then you can press A for all, U, and then unwrap. And now you can see that the edges we've marked have allowed us to create these looping bands around our object, and you can see it's represented here in the UV. But rather than looping bands, we need straight lines, so Blender understands better what we're trying to do with tissue. So to do that, I'm going to go to the top view, and I'm going to want to turn these loops into straight lines. So to do that, I need to cut the loop in half. So I'm just going to left click these edges, and shift left click them to select multiple. Now I have them all selected, it should look something like this. And now all we need to do is right click again and choose mark seam. Remember, if you're not in edge select mode, which is this button here or two on the keyboard, you won't get the option to mark seam when you right click. Now I can press A, U, and then unwrap again. And now you can see we've got these straight strips rather than loops. This will be enough in order for tissue to understand how I want to orientate my faces. Now, if I left click my tessellation, come down to rotation, and I change it from default to active UV, you can see everything is orientated correctly. If you haven't any issues with this, I recommend left clicking your component, shift left clicking your torus again, which is your base, and then tessellating again. You can see that it disabled my shade smooth as well. If you want to stop this from happening, you can enable this smooth shading and it will do it every time you refresh it. But we still have a bit of a problem. It's looking a little bit jagged. Also, if you come down to active UV and you press the shift button, I can now rotate it in the other direction, giving me even more flexibility. But we still have a bit of a problem, and that's that this is still looking a bit jagged. This is where the power of patch comes in. If I come back to my torus here, come to my modifiers here, press the add modifier, search, and then choose subdivision surface, now we have a smoother base to work with. I'll maybe change this to an intensity of 2, and I'm going to delete my tessellation since we don't need it now. Now then, left click my component, shift left click my torus, open my side menu with N, and then where it says tissue, I'll left click tessellate. If I leave it on quad and press OK, you can see we have loads of really small components, which is not what we're going for. I'll go to my green triangle, which will allow me to edit my settings, and I'll press G and Y to move it along. The first problem is things aren't orientated correctly again, and that's because by default, our rotation is on default. So I'm going to change it from default to active UV again. Now you can see everything is orientated the right way. I'll also turn on my smooth shading and I'll turn on merge. Another problem we have is that our components are too small, and this is because it is using the subdivided torus here, but we want to use the original squares that still have the smoothness of the subdivision surface. That's where the power of patch comes in. So I'll come up to fill mode and change it from quad to patch. And now you can see we have our swirl shape that we were going for. Great, well done for creating your own swirl. And that's today's lesson over. In the next lesson, we're going to be setting up the scene so we're ready to start animating. Also, if you have any questions about today's lesson, feel free to let me know in the comment section below. Now though, we're going to have a quick quiz to cover what we learned today. Number one, what is the difference between the quad fill mode and the patch fill mode? Number two, in our project, what was the component and what was the base? Number three, which menu did we edit our tessellation settings in? Feel free to pause the video and then play when you're ready to answer the questions. Number one, what is the difference between quad and patch? Quad will place the component on each square of the base, whereas patch will do the same thing, but it will take the subdivision's smoothness into account without its extra faces. Number two, what was our component and base in our project? If you remember, the component is placed on the base, so the component would be our object here, whereas the base would be our torus. Number three, where do we find the tissue tessellate settings? This can be found in the green triangle called the Object Data Properties menu, under a tab called Tissue Tessellate. You will find this on the tessellation rather than the base. Also, if you enjoy my teaching style, I also provide one-on-one coaching, complete with personalized lessons and post-lesson quiz questions and support. Link in the description if you're interested. Thank you for making it to the end of the video. You can also support the channel by making a one-time donation through Super, but even just liking, subscribing, and sharing if you enjoyed is more than enough to support the channel. Thank you again for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Take care.